In order to gain insight in the various aspects of your design, you can simulate these aspects with a prototype. You make this prototype mainly for yourself to help you understand what you are designing, but it's also for your intended users to ask feedback and for your client or other stakeholders to communicate your design. Thus, building a model or prototype should be seen as an important part of a design process. In most products, we distinguish three aspects that can be simulated separately. The first is usage. If you want to see if your intended users are able to understand and use your product as intended. The second is technical function. If you want to gain insight in the mechanical functioning or if you'd like to explain the operating principles of your design to your stakeholders. And the last is form. If you want to study form details in true scale and in three dimensions. If you want to have feedback from intended users on the total experience, or if you want to convince your client and stakeholders. When you've determined the goal of your prototype, you first need to make a plan. You choose your own materials and tools in order to achieve your goal as directly as possible. We prefer to use materials that are easily available, accessible, and easy to process with the available tools. Of course, you can always use 3D printing if possible. This rapid prototyping technique can save time, but the disadvantage is that the design needs to be detailed on the computer in advance, while modeling by hand makes it possible to make decisions on the go. For prototypes testing the usage of your design, your material choice depends highly on whether your hypothesis requires an examination of cognitive understanding or physical interaction of the product. In an early stage, visual two-dimensional interfaces can be prototyped out of paper or cardboard sheets that can be positioned in layers to simulate the alternating screens. For prototypes that aim to study the physical interaction, body measures, locomotion, and tactile possibilities especially need to be taken into account. Materials like cardboard, plywood, and rod material could do the work. If your aim is to demonstrate the technical functioning of your design, then you need to abstract it to simple, insightful elements, often made out of sheet material and profiles. For needed mechanical transmissions, you can buy standard parts, gears, bearings, and axes. Also, the possibility of modular building blocks, such as Meccano or Fisher technique, are suitable for this application. If you want to visualize the appearance of a closed form, then styrene foam is an easy material to process, leading quickly to results. If the design has a more skeleton-based character, then rod material out of metal, wood, and plastic in combination with sheet materials, such as cardboard, triplex, and aluminum, offer good possibilities. After you have drawn your concept on paper, you need to make a building plan. A plan consists of side views with measures of length, width, and material thickness. In many cases, it is needed to make a list of all the parts needed to build the model. Your prototype might look quite different from your final design. Therefore, most of the time it is needed to make a specific drawing of your prototype in advance before you develop your building plan. For this video clip, it's impossible to show you all the possible techniques for prototyping. A good result will partially depend on your own creativity, knowledge, and skills that you will develop during your education and practice. Here, we'll give you some random examples. A handmade prototype made out of hard foam can be built in layers, taking into account the various thicknesses of the available foam sheets. Out of each layer, you will make a front view out of thick paper. This sheet of paper will be used as a mask or mold that can be traced before you start cutting the foam. For straight cuts, you can use a guide. For circles, you can use a simple wooden plate with a nail. For free forms, guided by hand, you need to take care that you always cut outside of your lines to avoid unwanted holes in your prototype. To obtain the right curves, make a mold out of the same foam to help guide you. After gluing several layers of foam, you can finish them firstly with a coarse sandpaper, and after that with finer quality sandpaper for the details. The final surface will be sleekest if you end with waterproof sandpaper and water. For prototypes that simulate the technical function, we can choose materials that approach the imagined reality as close as possible. For models or components that are constructed from sheet metal, zinc is often a good choice. It is easy to cut and form by hand, with simple tools. Because of its soft texture, zinc is also easy to finish, and the surface can even get a silvery quality. Connections can be made by soldering, which can be mastered quickly with some practice. Also, plastic sheet metal, for example styrene, in different thicknesses is well suited for the building of simple prototypes. You can get straight cuts by notching with a craft knife first, then breaking off the edge. For round and curved forms, use the jigsaw. You get the best result when the bonded surfaces are aligned and fitted perfectly, and when the material is finished smoothly. Special adhesive material is on the market for this. Put the finishing touches on the model as a final edit by polishing with fine, waterproof sandpaper to get an almost seamless effect. You can find detailed product descriptions and tips and tricks for all kinds of materials and techniques online and in guides. Of course, on the route from good idea to successful product, several prototypes will be made. Some of them will be more advanced and will also simulate several aspects simultaneously. In the end, your final prototype must represent the actual product as it will appear on the market.